and welcome to Bethel Baptist Church 2021. Happy New Year! I am so glad that you have tuned in and joined us this morning. Now you might notice that I'm not in church, we're not in church, I'm at my house. And that's because, as many of you know, Kyle tested positive for COVID back on Christmas Day. And so the rest of us are just isolating just to make sure that none of us get it and none of us pass it on to anybody else, and just to keep everybody safe. So apologies that we're not in church today, apologies that we're not live, but hopefully you can still meet with God and you can still learn more about Jesus, even though this is pre-recorded. We've got a great service coming up. Loads planned. Each of us are going to share a little bit of our vision for 2021 for our ministries, and John's going to share a communion with us as well. So you might even want to pause this video and go and grab yourself some bread and some wine or juice or squash or whatever you've got in your house, so that you can share in the first communion of 2021 with us. Now, as I think about the new year and as I think about 2021, you know, 2020 has been difficult, but this verse has really spoken to me this last week. Hebrews 13 verse 8, which says, Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And I just really pray that you will know that in your lives. So let's pray before we get into a bit of worship to start this morning. Dear Father God, I thank you so much that you are the same yesterday, today, and forever. You were the same in 2019 as you were in 2020, even though 2020 was weird and scary at times and hurtful at times. But Father, you are the same God then, and you are the same God now as we start 2021. And I just pray that my friends who are tuning in this morning, that they would meet you, that they would know you, and that they would grow to love you more and more. Amen. so I get to kick us off with my vision for kids ministry in 2021. And you know, when I first started kids ministry, I thought the most important thing was to teach them the stories of the Bible and to give them a good knowledge of the basic kind of stories, you know, the Noah and the Ark, the Jonah and the whale, David and Goliath, all of those really great stories that we tell children. I thought that was the most important thing. But it kind of almost always felt like we were catching up. Like we were trying to get to the same level as the adults. But I want our children to have access to all the things that grown-ups have access to. I want to see them worship their Lord with their whole heart. I want to see them praying for the sick. I want to hear them knowing the prophetic voice of God. I want them to lead people to Jesus. But some days I feel like that's impossible. I feel like that it's just going to take too long to pursue, and actually by the time that we've reached that point, there'll be young people in youth, or they'll even be adults. But you know what? The truth is that our children have in their hands the exact same inheritance that the adults do. They have the exact same inheritance, the exact same power and authority that I do, that we do. You can live out the call of God in your life, no matter how old you are. And it can be hard sometimes to find the right place for kids. They often aren't part of the core kind of church, and they don't have money to contribute. In fact, they're quite labour intensive. They require a lot of volunteers to give a regular amount of time. And so it can be really hard to work out how kids fit. But if we look at it through a different pair of lenses, if we look at it in a different way, children have so much more energy than us, don't they? You know, I've been in lockdown with two kids since March. Oh my gosh, do they have energy that I don't have? And their faith, their expectation of God is unswerving and unmoving and uncomplicated. They just expect God to do because that's what they know, and they haven't been tainted by the world yet. You know, they're great gatherers, they're great tip talking points. I often use Asher because I can be really awkward sometimes in social situations. And Asher, as a baby, as a toddler, he can be a really good way of breaking the ice. You know, sometimes people will receive gifts from children or invitations from children that they would reject if they had it offered by adults. So rather than being barriers, children can actually melt the barriers and become a vital and effective part of church life. If we want adults in church to own and grow and be passionate about our vision and our values, then we need to start teaching it to our children now. If we feed them on a diet of anything less than the truth and don't give them the chance to experience God's life-changing we are selling them short. We're selling them short if we don't give them the same opportunities that we give our adults. You know, they may drift, they may find the transition into adult church harder if we try and sell the gospel short to them, if we try and make the truth different for them. You know, in our programs in Livewires and K-Motion, we always focus on loads of fun, on building friendships, on building relationships, because you know, children are often brought to church whether they like it or not. They're hurled into this alien environment and suddenly they're expected to get on with children that they may never have met and may have nothing in common with. But if we believe that God's truth is relevant to all ages, and not just in all ages, then we should try to give children a balance of old and new, a balance of godly values and practical life issues. We should provide them an opportunity to tithe, to spend time in worship and to minister to one another and even to adults. Wouldn't that be mental if we let the children actually pray for some of us adults? Children are a vital part of the whole church. We can find creative ways to engage them, to involve them, rather than keeping them constrained and in their own little pocket, their own little bubble, and following old models and old programs that worked then and may not work now, especially after the year we've just had. And you know, that's all very nice. It all sounds good, doesn't it? I sound like I'm kind of selling you on this. But what does it actually look like? You know, 2020 has been a really tough year, but it's helped me reevaluate what's important. And I want to stop tiptoeing around the gospel. I want to stop pretending that the children need to wait until they're young people. They need to wait until they're adults before they can live out their calling. And you know, the longer that I've been in lockdown, this question has been playing on my mind. First it started with, wow, if I'd known that March was the last time I'd speak to some of these children for 9 months, what would I have said to them? And then that kind of developed into me thinking, if I had known that that was the last time ever that I would speak to them, what if I knew that tomorrow would be the last time I ever spoke to our children at Bethel? What would I want them to know? What would I want to say? And now I don't have an exact answer to that, but I know that I would want to empower them to live out their calling, not just to fill their head with Bible stories. And I know that that's important. Bible stories are so important, and biblical foundations is so important. But if I had one thing that I could do for our children, that I could do with our children, it would be to empower them to know and believe who they are and what their calling is with God. So looking into 2021, I've got no idea what the year holds. I've got no idea how much longer we'll be in lockdown. I've got no idea how long it's going to be until we can gather together. And so it's really hard to plan practical things. It's really hard to say, do you know what, in February I'm going to open up, I'm going to have this many clubs and this many people are going to come in and that many families are going to come to church and blah, 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 blah. You know, I'd love to be able to do that, but I can't, not for this year. And actually, should I be doing it for the years anyway? You know, is it about who we get into the church and the bums on seat, or is it about the heart of how we value children, of how we view children in Bethel? You know, church should be a second home full of uncles and aunties and brothers and sisters and the weird annoying cousin that you don't even really want to get to know. That's what church should be, and our children have missed out on that. We've missed out on that, haven't we? But our children have missed out on that over the last few months. And so my biggest heart desire for 2021 is to get the kids back in church, to get our kids back together in church. And not even just so that they can worship God, but just so they can run around in that building that should be a safe place for them, a home for them, somewhere where they know they are loved and accepted and belong. You know, that is my deepest heart's desire. I am desperate to get our kids back into the building. And then once we're in the building, once we're back together, my focus is going to be on Livewires. I'm wearing the t-shirt for you. There you go, Livewires t-shirt. Because I want our church to be intentional about sharing the gospel with children. You know, the midweek clubs are great and it would be amazing to open those back up, but I know that it's going to be a slow process in reopening. And so our focus is going to be on Livewires. It's going to be on providing children with their own space to worship, their own church to serve in, their own opportunities to respond to the Holy Spirit, to the gospel message, in whatever way that looks like for them, whatever way feels comfortable for them. Do you know, it would be great if then they started inviting other families, other friends, because do you know what? They're meeting Jesus in Bethel, and they want other people to meet Jesus too, because they understand how life-changing that is. They know that it's more than a story. That's what I want for our kids. And in the meantime, while we can't meet together in person, I want to empower you at home to help your child meet Jesus and experience the Holy Spirit. Do you know, lockdown has shown me how much I took church for granted, how much I relied on church to teach my children, which I know sounds funny because I'm the Sunday school teacher, the Livewires teacher, whatever you want to call me, the kids pastor. You know, you'd think that I'd have it down at home, but you know, even I relied on church. You know, I'd think, oh, it's okay, I'll teach him that on Sunday when we're in Livewires. And then lockdown happened and suddenly the responsibility was on me, and it always had been on me, and it always had been on you as parents as well. But I want to make sure that I can empower you so that you at home can introduce your children to Jesus, even if they can't come to church. And I'm not trying to make myself redundant. Trust me, lockdown has made me feel redundant enough. But it's so important that the children have opportunities to meet Jesus, to meet the Holy Spirit, to pray, to worship, and just to experience what it means to be a Christian at home, to see you living your life as a Christian at home, to see Jesus in everything that you do. And so until we can meet again together, until I can see your kids, and I cannot wait to see most of them again, I'm joking, I want to see them all again. I want to empower you at home. I want to be the person that you can call up on the end of the phone. You know, I've had some great experiences of that during lockdown, and I want more of that. People ringing me and saying, hey Meg, someone's died and I need to know what book can I read to my four-year-old, because they just don't get it, they don't understand, and they're really sad. You know, get in touch with me if there's an issue that's coming up at home, or if there's something that your child keeps asking, or if there's a situation that you need some advice on. Get in touch with me. I kind of maybe sort of know, and if I don't, I know people who do know, and that's what I'd love to do until we can meet again, is just to really empower you to be confident in sharing the gospel with your kids so that they can share the gospel with their friends in their schools. I hope that's okay. I think I'm handing back to some more worship, but I don't know, because I'm in my house. Lonely.
Well, good morning. I'm really glad that you've been able to join me this morning. I'm going to be sharing with you on our brand new series called Restarts. Restart is a series based in the book of Nehemiah. And for many of you that you would know that when Nehemiah went to explore what had been happening to God's people in Jerusalem and the walls had been broken down, that it really stirred him and moved him. And he sought God, and God placed in Nehemiah a passion and a desire to change the environment that he was in. I want to share with you right at the beginning our very, very first sermon, and it's called A Time to Remember. And I'm going to read from Ecclesiastes chapter 3, where Solomon, the great wisdom-filled Solomon, writes these words. There's a time for everything. There's a time for everything and a reason for every activity under heaven. There's a time to be born and there's a time to die. There's a time to plant and a time to uproot. There's a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to tear down and a time to build, a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance, a time to scatter stones and a time to gather them in, a time to embrace, a time to refrain, a time to search and a time to give up, a time to keep and a time to throw away, a time to tear and a time to mend, a time to be silent and a time to speak, a time to love and a time to hate, a time for war and a time for peace. What does the worker gain from his toil? I have seen the burden God has laid on men. He has made everything beautiful in his time. He has set eternity in the hearts of men, yet they cannot fathom what God has done from beginning to end. Verse 11, he has made everything beautiful in his time. He has set eternity in the hearts of men. And I love this, but when we're looking at a time for this and a time for that and a time for the other, we must remember that God has made everything beautiful in his time. We are in his time. And I want to ask you a question. Is God still the same? When we look at today at this time to remember, when we look back on where we've been, we might even look back at 2020, we might even look back further than that, but is God the same? And what has God done in your life? And I want you to remember the greatness of God, the power of God, the awesomeness of God, the majesty of God. And what I thought I would do is I've written down the 15 attributes of God, as we remember where we've come from. So many people remember history relating to how it affects them. But I want to encourage you today that God remains the same. God remains the same yesterday, today, and will remain the same tomorrow. As we begin 2021, as we look at this time to remember, I want you to grasp hold of with me today. And sometimes I've not grasped hold of it. Sometimes I've let go of what God has been doing in my life, in my family, and in His church. And I hold on to God, and I go back to who God is in my life. And I want to share with you 15 attributes of God. And if you've got a pen, write them down. If you've got Google, Google these and you'll find them as well. But I want to encourage you with these, that God is infinite, number one. Number two, God is immutable. In other words, God never changes. Number three, God is all sufficient. Number four, God is omnipotence. In other words, God is all powerful. God is omniscient. He is all knowing. God is all powerful and God is all knowing. Where are you going to put your trust? Number six, God is omnipresent. God is everywhere. You know, God is in these woods here with me now. God is has filled me with the power of His Holy Spirit. And God is in your house right there with you now. God is wise. What God does is filled and full of wisdom. God is faithful. You know that God is faithful. Great is thy faithfulness. He will never fail you. He will never let you down. He will never, ever turn His back on you. God is good. It's a phrase that many people say to one another, don't they? You know, how are you today? God is good. But how often do we say it and not believe it? God is good. God is just. God is right and perfect in all He does. He is just. God is a God of justice. And God is just. He is right and perfect in all He does. God is merciful. God is gracious. God is loving. God is holy. God is glorious. You see, for you and for me, we grasp hold of, don't we, who God is. And today, as we remember, as we look back, and when Nehemiah, in Nehemiah chapter 1, began to inquire as to the state of Jerusalem, as to the state of the walls of Jerusalem, he heard a bad report. But for Nehemiah, the bad report was one thing, but his faith, his confidence, and his trust in God is a completely different thing. So who is God to you? Is God those 15 words and characteristics of God? Do you hold onto them, that God is omnipresent, that God is loving, that God is all of those things that we believe Him to be? Do you say amen from your home? Or do you just look at me blankly on the screen and so say, that bloke's talking to me again? I want you to grasp it. I want you to believe it. I want you to shout hallelujah. I want you to leap up from your chair, because these are the things that we hold on to in God, don't we? We don't hold on to His building. We don't hold on to the things that we used to have. We hold on to who God is in our life right here, right now. And we remember where we've come from, don't we? We remember that slimy pit, and we remember a God who loves us, a God who cares for us, and a God who is with us. It wasn't long ago that we were talking about Emmanuel, God with us. And when it comes now to this time to remember, we remember that our God is mighty, that our God is a deliverer, that our God is a healer. And you add to that what God is to you. Who is God in your life, and what has He done, and what is He going to do? Nehemiah, we remember, was alone, but he still believed that his God was mighty, that his God was powerful, that his God was able to change the circumstances and situation, not just for him, but for God's people and those people that would come to Jerusalem following him in years and years to come. Elijah felt alone, didn't he? And as we go into 2021, you might feel alone. You might wonder what's going to happen. You might wonder what's going to happen to your job. You might wonder what's going to happen to your marriage. You might wonder what's going to happen to your church building. You might wonder all of these things. But Elijah was on his own. He was on his own against the prophets of Baal. And I think there was something like 400 prophets of Baal, and they were wailing and they were screaming and they were shouting and they were rubbishing Elijah. They were ridiculing his God. And Elijah knew that his God was mighty. His God was a deliverer. His God was powerful. His God was able to change the circumstances. And his God brought down that fire from heaven and burnt up the offering. You see, when we give to God what we have, we remember, don't we, the power of God that was at work in the past, that will still be at work in the present. You and I, we believe today, don't we? Come on, church, we believe today, don't we, that the God of Nehemiah, the God of Elijah, the God of David is that same God that will be the God of 2021 here in Pontyclun. The God of David that against all odds looked at that giant Goliath and said, today God will deliver you into my hands. We believe, don't we, today? We believe that our God is mighty, our God is powerful. We remember where we've come from. We remember what God has done in the past. We remember how God has saved people, how we have seen people baptized, how we have seen people healed in Bethel. We remember those things, don't we? We remember those personal experiences and encounters with the living Lord Jesus Christ. We remember those moments in worship when the tears streamed down our face, when our arms were aloft and we were shouting, Lord, 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 I'll go anywhere. I'll do anything for you. I love you, Lord. I worship you, Lord. We remember those moments, don't we? We hold on to those moments where God was the closest and the nearest to us. And now where are we in 2021? It's time to restart, church. It's time to restart the engine, restart the car, get on our knees before the living Lord Jesus Christ, repent of all those things that we've gone into, repent of the times that we've ignored him, repent of the times that we've been apathetic, lethargic, negative, and critical, and worship him again. Worship him in this new year, in this new season, in this new moment, in this new opportunity. The world was given the greatest ever gift, and that greatest ever gift was Jesus Christ. And we remember, don't we, 2,000 years ago, that Jesus was given as a small baby. Even this time last week, I was preaching and we were sharing about Jesus and how he was Emmanuel, God with us, how Jesus is the reason why we are and who we are and we do what we do and we believe what we believe. And Jesus was given to this world as a small baby, lived for 33 years and died on a cross. And you know, when Jesus died on that cross, he died so that we might be saved, so that we might be set free, and so that we might enter into an eternal relationship with God, our Father in heaven. And as I read in Ecclesiastes chapter 3 and verse 11, he has made everything beautiful in his time. And wait for it. This is going to knock your socks off, the next verse. He has set eternity in the hearts of men. He has set eternity in the hearts of men. You see, when we look back into the Old Testament, it's a time for us to remember that when Jesus died and he rose again, and that we enter into that relationship with him, and we enter into that relationship with God the Father, he has set eternity in our hearts. Read that over and over again for your scripture for today. He has set eternity in the hearts of man. You see, we're at the beginning of our eternal relationship with God. Through Jesus' death on the cross, he made a way, and he made a way for you and for me to enter into that eternal relationship with him. Nothing in all this world will separate you from that eternal relationship with God. Well, I'm going to sit down on my little bench that I've put together, some logs here, and I'm going to share a communion with you. You see, for you and for me, we've entered into our eternal relationship with God. Through what Jesus did for us on the cross, there is nothing in all this world that can separate us from him. And I want you to join me. You can't come into the woods at the moment, but I want you to join me. I hope that you'll still be able to hear, but I want you to join me in this time to remember. This time where you and I remember what Jesus has done, what Jesus has accomplished for you and for me on the cross. And in this time to remember, we're going to pray for some people, and we're going to remember those people that are going through a particularly difficult time. So I hope you can hear, but I'm going to read from 1 Corinthians chapter 11, and it says this: "For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body. This is remembrance of my body.'" This is our remembrance of Jesus, the time to remember. "And this is my body, which has been given for you." So please take your piece of bread and eat a piece of it, and remember and be thankful for what Jesus has done for you and for me. Oh, thank you. Oh, thank you. Hallelujah. Praise you, King of Kings, Majesty, God of heaven, living in me. We thank you. We thank you. Praise him, praise him. And then after supper, Jesus took the cup and he said, "This is the new covenant in my blood. Drink this. And when we drink this, we remember that Jesus died for all of our sin. He died for all of our shame, and he died for all of our guilt. We thank you, Jesus, that you gave your life so that I might live and I might enjoy a relationship with you on earth and await that eternal relationship in heaven. So drink with me and be thankful that Jesus died for all of your sin." I'd like us to pray now. Oh, Father God, we come before you as we remember all that you have done for us, Jesus. And as we have taken this bread and we've drunk from this cup, we know that there's healing in you, Jesus. We know that there's healing from sickness. We know that there's healing from mental illness and stress and anxiety. We know that there's healing in you. So we ask for healing for our dear friends that are on this call. I ask you for healing for three people that would be part of church every single week. We pray for Drusilla Allen. She's close to coming out of hospital, but I don't quite know whether she's out or whether she's not. Lord, we pray for Drusilla, who's been in hospital for so long. We pray, Lord, that you will heal her, that you will touch her, that you will bless her, that you'll encourage her, that you'll be all that she needs at this particular moment and season of her life. And Lord, we pray for John Evans as well, as he's been in hospital. I believe that he's home now, but Lord, I pray for strength to come to his body. I pray for mental strength, and I pray for spiritual strength, and I pray for physical strength for John Evans. Lord, you know what he needs. Lord, you know what he's gone through. And I pray in the name of Jesus that you would touch this man, this dear man of God, and that you will encourage him in this season and in this moment. And for David Mills, Lord, who's come out of hospital, I think yesterday or a few days ago. Lord, we love David. He's such a dear, servant-hearted, special guy. And Lord, when we hear that he's unwell, our hearts are moved and our hearts are stirred. So Lord, I pray that you'll be with David. I pray that as he comes home, and that June and David will be able to cope, will be able to look after one another, and that you will give them a special touch of your hand and of your Holy Spirit. Lord, I pray for everyone on this call. There are needs galore in our church at this moment, and the pastoral team and the pastors and the life group leaders, we find it so hard to cope. And Lord, we just give every single person to you. And we pray in the name of Jesus that the people on this call, they will reach out to you, and that you will reach out to them. Father God, we ask for miracles to happen in 2021. We ask for physical healing of people's bodies. We ask for healing of people's minds. We ask to see economic miracles. As we look back at what you've done in the past, your provision in the past is still the same as your provision in the future. And Father God, we pray for relational miracles as well, for relationships with children, with parents, relationships within marriages to be made whole where they were once broken. Father God, we thank you for this time. We know that you're a God whose hand is still at work, and that you will be our Jehovah Jireh, that you will be the provider for these people and for me. Lord, we love you, we worship you, and we thank you so much that you're our rock, that you're our redeemer, and that you are Yeshua, our salvation. We pray this in Jesus' precious name and for his glory. Amen. So thank you so much for being with me today. I've absolutely loved sharing to this camera in the middle of the woods. I hope you felt the presence and power of the Holy Spirit. And just as I close, there's five things that I want you to remember. Remember who God is. Remember his mighty works. Remember that God loves you no matter what's going on. Remember what he has done for you in the past. And remember that he is still Emmanuel, God with us. God bless you. Amen. I'd just like to hand back to Rachel and Karina, who continue to lead us in worship. Thank you so much. Thank you.
So 2021, a new year, a new season for us here at Bethel. We thought it'd be good to share some thoughts that I have around youth, how I see Bethel youth looking going forward into this new year. I think it's going to be exciting, but I also think it's going to be really challenging because we've spent months and months doing things online. And maybe this year now is sort of that change where we're able to do a lot more in building. But how is that transition going to look? Are people willing to come back into the church? Are the young people wanting to come back to church? A church that looks different to how they first came in. Things done differently. So yeah, it's going to be a challenging time, I think, but I think it's going to be really exciting as well to see what God is going to do. I'm just going to share some thoughts around the youth, what I see in 2021 for the youth and how we do that. So basically, I want to share the mission and the vision of Bethel Youth. The vision, quite simply, is to find the lost and equip the found. To find the lost and to equip the found. So going into communities, talking to people about Jesus, and then when they found their own faith, to disciple them, to encourage them in their daily walk with God. You know, it sounds so simple, but I'm sure you know there is a lot more difficult than just saying it. But that's the vision, that's the goal for Bethel Youth, to find the lost and to equip the found. How do we do that? Well, I believe is through our mission. So what is our mission? What does that look like? So passionately, purposefully, and practically loving God and loving people. Passionately, practically, and purposefully loving God and loving people. And that's how I see us moving forward. That's what I want from the youth, for us to love passionately, for us to do things purposefully, for us to be practical with our hands, to be God's hands and feet in different ways, trying to serve the church and wider community in all things that we do. I'm excited for this year. I think it's going to be great, but I just thought I'd share that with you, the vision and the mission of the church going forward. Now, I don't think it's going to be easy. I think this time's going to be hard. Like I said, you know, this transition that we'll probably have this year is going to be difficult for people to come back into the building and to come away from spending the majority of their church life online. But I believe it's exciting, and God's given us a great opportunity to start new things, to start afresh, which I think is great. So what does the youth program look like then for 2021? Now, due to COVID, we've had to tweak a few things. So there's some things that I'm not going to share with you today that are sort of in that are going to happen, but not until COVID allows us to do that. So I'm just going to share some things that will be happening right at the start of 2021. We're going to have an early morning prayer meeting. Young people coming on Zoom, half an hour, just a time to pray together before they go to school. And then we're going to have a Bible study together, which is also going to be in the morning for half an hour. That's going to be a lot of self-reflection rather than someone just sharing to them. It gives everyone a chance to see what God is saying to them through that passage, because God speaks to us in different ways through the same passage. So we're just giving people an opportunity to hear from the voice of God. Friday Night Live is still going to be happening, probably online for maybe the next few months. We're going to change the name as well to The Gathering, which basically means we all gather. That's the whole point of the name. It comes from Neil Hudson's approach of the scattered and gathered. So to bring all the people together, to equip, to disciple, to love on them so they go out and make disciples themselves. That's sort of the goal, and that is the thinking behind that. We're also going to have life groups as well, which we're sort of splitting them into smaller groups now and being really intentional about doing life together, because that's the point of a life group, to do life together. So that's sort of a few things that the youth is going to do during this year. We're just trying to implement a sort of rhythm to people's lives. So, you know, getting up early in the morning, going into the Word of God, reading that from themselves, praying to God in the morning before they go to school, gathering together, seeing friends, doing life together. That's what I see from this youth group. A youth group that can change the world, but we need to be a church that gives them the tools and equips them to go and do that. So I'm excited for 2021. I hope you are too. I hope you're wanting to see God moving in amazing ways during this time. And I pray that he will move through this youth group in mighty ways. So let's pray for the youth now, and then I'm going to hand back to the worship team who are going to lead us in some more worship. Jesus, I thank you so much for the young people that we have at Bethel. I pray, Lord, that even though coronavirus would have affected their lives, Lord, that it hasn't affected their relationship with you. And this year is a new start for them to develop their relationship, to implement a rhythm into their lives that will help them to be who you want them to be. In Jesus' name, amen. Thanks to everyone who took part in today's service. Hope that has blessed you. We're going to be back here the same time, same place next week. I'm going to pray to close the service. Jesus, thank you so much that we're able to do this, Lord, that we're able to gather as a church. I pray, Lord, for this year, for this season, that you will come and do amazing things through us and through your church. In Jesus' name, amen.